Over the past few months, we've covered an extraordinary array of topics. We've looked at aspects of biology ranging from molecules, the DNA, all the way to ecosystems and entire planets. There are a few take-home messages I hope that you will keep after this class is finished. The first is the recognition that all aspects of life can be investigated, that science has value in asking almost anything that you're interested in about our existence. We can ask, why is there sex? Why is it takes two individuals to produce a single offspring? Where there is sex, why is it that males are the ones that always show off so much more than the females? Why is it we grow old? Why do we have senescence? Why do we die? Why are we so smart? What is it that's made some species develop extraordinary intelligence compared to others? And why are we social? Why do we live in groups? And when we are in groups, what determines the way we behave towards each other? These are all topics that are covered in one way or another by evolution and biology. Within the last few weeks, I've focused more on ecology, and I think there's some exceptionally important lessons to be learned from these final lectures. The first is that growth has limits. We saw that if you put money in the bank and accepted a certain percentage of growth, this could not persist for more than a few hundred years at a time. We know that there are huge struggles right now between businesses, private individuals who hope to keep expanding our economies, to keep growing more and more wealth off of a limited amount of resources. And we see that this has had a huge impact and has enormous implications on the sustainability of life on Earth. This has led to a huge conflict that plays out every day in the press and in the media. On the one hand, you see business interests who would like us to believe that the most important thing is current short-term employment, and there's certainly an important argument to be made for that. On the other hand, we see that environmentalists can be a little bit carried away in how imminent our demise may be. There is still time. There are things that we can still do. But when people like Paul Ehrlich wrote The Population Bomb, this was like crying wolf. This was like setting off a certain amount of hysteria that undermined any credibility there could be in ecological sustainability. The business interests have fought back by saying environmentalists are inherently against economic growth. Ecologists fight back saying, well, wait a minute, there are ways that you can grow without being quite so damaging on the environment. It goes back and forth, back and forth. But the truth is that both sides will have to be represented in whatever solutions are developed. Obviously, people do need the security of their livelihoods, but we also need to have the security of a long-term future. We know that we will eventually reach these limits, and there are signs already. As world population has continued to grow exponentially, there are signs that, indeed, agricultural production can only grow linearly. If you divide annual growth in food production by the human population, the per capita production reached a peak back in the 1980s. Peak food is already passed. We're now not growing as much food per person as we did before. The first signs of this Malthusian nightmare are actually coming upon us. If we look at the consequences economically, it's simple supply and demand. As the supply goes down and the demand continues to grow, prices will go up. And we've seen in the last few years enormous inflation in food costs in many developing nations, which has led to widespread unrest as people feel less and less secure about their safety and welfare. Also, we're going to see enormous consequences of climate change in the coming decades. Crop production is expected to decline as the temperature around the world rises, especially once it gets above the limit of about 86 degrees Fahrenheit. And droughts are becoming more common. The more droughts, the less reliable the food supply. The third thing I'd like you to take with you is the fact that poverty is the enemy of ecological sustainability in many ways that you might not have expected. If we look at average family size across the world, it's the poorest countries in the world that have the largest families. And the underlying reasons for this high population growth in these poor countries is that they still experience high infant mortality, and women in these countries still have a very low economic status. So The root issue of the population problem on the global scale is poverty. What can be done? This is where I would call upon you to investigate your own opportunities while you're here. Do what you can. Get engaged. Try to fight poverty. There are many opportunities here at the University of Minnesota for you to travel, especially to third world countries. See the world. Volunteer. See what you can do to help out. There are global programs at the university. There are all kinds of opportunities for you to get engaged in CFANS, CLA, and IT. Next is that wealth is consuming irreplaceable resources. If we look at the night sky, looking down on the North American continent, we see a lot of areas lit up at night because we're burning electricity 24 hours a day, lighting up our cities. But there are also areas here that are kind of surprising. I mean, here's Minneapolis over here, here's Chicago and places, but what's over there? That's North Dakota. That's in a very uninhabited part of North Dakota. That's not even near the capital of Bismarck or the other town of Minot. North Dakota is now the home of enormous development for extracting natural gas through a process called fracking. Now, natural gas has plenty of advantages for meeting our energy needs. Natural gas consumes a lot less, or produces a lot less carbon dioxide than does coal, but this is just an indication of the scale of our demand, that these gas fields are spread out over an area that you can easily see from space, indicates just how enormous are our demands on energy in this country. Part of the resistance for accepting the impacts of our own activities on the global climate comes from business interests who are reliant on the constant production of a great deal of energy. So conservation is inconvenient, or it feels like it's optional to most developed nations. If you look across the world, countries like the US are producing far more CO2 per capita than are these poor nations. We're the ones with the greatest responsibility to cut our consumption. The root issue is, in fact, that we do consume such an incredible amount of energy. What can we do? Well, all of us can act individually or as part of our local communities to cut consumption. We can eat smart. We can grow our own food. We can eat plants and fish. Some food sources have a really high carbon footprint. For example, livestock is a terrible source of carbon dioxide and methane. Cows are incredibly expensive in terms of carbon to produce beef. And this particular cow has been fit up with an amazing plastic bag that's capturing the gases of this cow's farts. These cows generate more greenhouse gases than cars. So replacing beef with other things like fish and a vegetarian diet even can do a lot to cut carbon emissions. Fishes can be really good. Here's one that's found in Southeast Asia that could also be domesticated in this country that actually thrives on human feces, which would be a great way to recycle carbon matter. So whatever you do, do think about it. And you don't always have to drive your own car. It's a good idea to walk. It's good exercise. Run. Exercise will help you to live longer, to be a healthier citizen, but mostly make sure to vote. Voting is really important because if we look at the overall emissions of carbon dioxide from U.S. over the last 15 years or so, there's a rather hopeful sign here. The emissions from the United States grew rapidly from 1990 up to about 2008. And since 2008, our actual emissions have gone down almost to the same level they were back in 1996. That's an extraordinary drop in just 5 years. Well, how was this achieved? It was achieved through these six different wedges. So it was a replacement of coal in many cases with natural gas, improved energy efficiency is the brown, fuel economy of cars, an addition of a lot more wind power. People aren't driving as much. They're not traveling as much as they used to. Altogether, people have cut consumption to the point where we're not such horrible villains in terms of carbon dioxide emission as we were just a few years ago. But the key thing is that these changes were partly, in the case of power plants, driven by regulations that encouraged power plants to convert from coal to gas, and also government regulations have worked in imposing greater energy efficiency on our appliances, on industrial equipment, the insulation in our houses, and also the economy of our cars. So this can work. And if we could keep this up, and if we could improve our efficiencies, we would get all the way back down maybe to what it was in about 1990, which was the original recommendation of the famous Kyoto Treaty that the American government has never actually officially adopted, but may end up meeting those goals through self-discipline. So there are a lot of things I hope you'll take away from this course. And now that you have learned a lot of things, and I hope have a greater interest in science than you might have otherwise, I hope you'll take your insights and your awareness of these kinds of issues and get involved in some way. Stay engaged. It's easy to be engaged in things while you're at college. There's a lot of opportunities on campus. But after you graduate and get out into the real world, stay engaged in whatever way you can. And most of all, make sure to vote. Be involved. Help mold future legislation. Because this is your home. For the next generation, this is going to be in your stewardship. And I hope that your generation will do a better job at looking after the planet than ours has.